create more and more of need in areas that already have high concentrations of poverty or of existing affordable housing or shelter units. And so you see that in the design of the places we pursue. That's, I think, a little bit about both how we've gotten from there to here, what our hope is on timing. After we got those sites finalized, we're going to be working on permitting. We're building tiny homes, and actually, we're not building, we're acquiring tiny homes, and pallet shelters would be deployed. Hotels will bring on board after we retrofit and prepare. So the idea is there, kind of think of October as a deployment preparation, with the idea that most of November and December would be focused on moving things. So I think I'm going to stop there because I know it's a very active bunch of citizens. I know you all have many questions. I thought I'd use an initial update at this stage right there. They're happy to jump in and answer questions you may have. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Mayor. Mark Paulus, in Fishing New York.
Great.
You mentioned entities that have a one-time cost. How are the budgeted costs for those?
Yeah, thank you. So we budget them separately. One is an acquisition cost. We use things like ARPA funds that are one-time dollars to do acquisition. We use ongoing city funds to do maintenance and services and support. As you probably know, all of these sites will come with full wraparound services. They'll have around-the-clock security to start with. We'll have mental health support, addiction treatment, workforce training. So all of those support services, both in 23 and in 24, are budgeted in an ongoing way out of ongoing city funds. Yeah, great question. Yes,
so, hi. Of the 1,000, how many will be in hotels? How many will be in community and
yeah, it's a great question. I'd say the biggest question mark for us right now are the number of leased units. I'll just be direct. That's been our biggest challenge so far, as we are both, it's a little slower on the procurement process because you can't just go to one hotel and buy it, go to one site and develop tiny homes. You have to negotiate with 500 different people at the same time, and they're all complicated in their own ways. So we'd like to get as many units into that tranche as we could, because it's the most long-term stability. So if we could get 300 or 400 units into leased units, that'd be fantastic. That would bring down our micro communities and our hotel needs. We're preparing to meet as many or as 800 or 900 of those units out of micro communities and hotels combined, so that if we are not successful in the lease units, we don't miss the target. But I'd say that we're the biggest unknown variable right now is how many of those apartments we can bring on. Yeah.
Mr. Mayor, before you take more questions, would you please repeat the questions for those of us in the virtual meeting? We can't hear the people in the room other than you.
Oh, yes. I'm so sorry. The question there was about what the balance of how many of these units would be leased units versus micro communities versus hotels. And the first question was about what about ongoing costs? How are we paying for those different than one-time costs? So thank you for that. I'll make sure and do that going forward. Yes.
Thank you.
You started with a plan. You had a state of emergency that you declared, and then you had 29 visits out to the community. Some people are supportive out in the community. Other people have howls of protests. What have you learned from the howls of protests that have made you modify the plan in any way?
Yeah, great question. Did you hear that question?
That one we did. He's close enough. Thank you.
Sitting in the front row, so I thought you had a better chance. So I think, as in all things, the loudest voices people pay the most attention to. So I would say by volume of people, I don't know that the folks that have concerns, I think, are a small percentage of the feedback we've gotten from the 4,000, but they're very valid concerns. So I think for me, what I've learned from them are a couple things. One is, I think people have fears about the way this is going to look based on the way that they see the current population of homelessness in the city today, which is, if you thought what we were bringing to your backyard was what you see right now in an encampment on 16th and Champa or on 8th and Logan or out front of the Union Station, you would have reasons to be very worried. The reason we're doing this is that the structure we're proposing is quite the opposite of that. And this is the data point I got from Chief Thomas I've been sharing, which is, if you look at right now the public, because people will say, what about public safety? And that's a very fair risk. And they're saying that because what they see right now is very unsafe, and they're correct about that. We looked at it in 2022, the total number of 911 calls to encampments, that number is about 8,000 911 calls to encampments in this city last year. You look at the number of calls to even large congregate shelter facilities. That number is still several thousand, 2,000 or 3,000 a year. If you look at the number of 911 calls to the micro communities that we're describing, one of those sites last year, over 12 months, had 3 911 calls. The other one had 14 911 calls. That is literally 1/1,000 of the safety risk of the homeless environment that exists today. And so, and that's because it has all the things the current sites don't have. It has round-the-clock security. It has rules about who can come and go. It has rules about use and distribution and any acts of violence. There's no walk-up services. You have mental health and addiction and workforce training all on site. You have bathrooms and showers and kitchens where folks can take care of their stuff. You have locked storage and facilities, so you don't have stuff strewn across the location. So all those things people are most worried about in the current environment, I think, is driving the concern. I think for folks that haven't seen or been to the type of environment we're constructing, that can be a hard jump to make. But I think that's the most common feedback we get. I think it's fair. Other ones extend to broader concerns about safety people have around the city. Well, a month ago, I called 911 and no one answered. What's going to happen if I have someone that lives next door to my house and there's a lack of safety and no one answers? And so those are important pieces of feedback we're hearing and taking action on separately in terms of PD response to issues like this. But those tend to be the most significant ones, is how much structure will it be? How much stability will it be? Will there be accountability for providers and for the city and for people that misbehave? And those things are all things that we'll be able to give good answers on. Yes.
When will we be able to find out more like logistical information about the sites in our neighborhood? I know for West Colfax, I think the first question we have is, where is the actual site? It's listed as the library, Arkansas Library, and I don't think that's the site. So when, again, we can release the sites, but like, how do we find out more information about what's going to be actually going on in our community so we can share it with our
Great question. On that site, we were looking at multiple locations, both the parking lot in the library as well as some adjacent parking lots. And there are some complexities we're working through with that site too, that's been more challenging than we thought. So not to say it's impossible, but we're hitting some challenges around different landowner structures in that neighborhood and who owns what, where, what access. So we got a couple of partners who are eager for us to try to use that site, and we're doing our best to work at it. But that will be a combination of negotiations with landowners, with neighbors, and with physical space. So shorter answer is these communities will continue to answer these questions. After we get farther along, if we stage a specific community meeting about that site, that would be when we would answer all the logistics about that specific site. But right now, I think until you see a community information meeting posted on that site, that means we're trying to do preemptory due diligence to see if it's viable. And until we get to that stage, we don't have the information to know that. Yeah, great question. Yes, ma'am.
There's a few concerns in my neighborhood at Bear Valley District 2,
yes.
Southwest Denver.
Yes.
That the homeless that are tiny homes or hotels or whatnot, obviously you said, and I agree, that they don't have to be clean and sober. They can just come in and then the community or whomever will work along with them. My neighbor's concerns are, what if that me, for instance, go in, and after 30, 90 days, I'm just like, no, I like what I'm doing, leave me alone. Is there a probationary period that that person, the security guard or whomever, will say, now you have to leave?
Did you all hear that question? Sorry, okay.
We can hear about every eighth word.
Okay. The third, seventh, and eighth words were questions, location. So the question was about, if we have a community in our neighborhood, and if someone comes into that micro community site, and if 1, 2, 3 months into it, they are not progressing towards, let's call it independence, getting themselves back on their feet, getting a unit, getting out on their own, what happens? Is that a fair summary?
Yes.
Of the question? Great. So the focus is always, we call this transitional supportive housing. It is not meant to be permanent. It's meant to be a transition from being on the street where you're at risk of dying to getting into your own unit long term. What we know, and you all probably know, is it is very hard for a lot of folks in the city to get into their own units right now. It's very hard for servers working 2 jobs. It's very hard for teachers. You know, 40% of the folks that are unhoused today are working. They actively have jobs and still can't afford access to units. So we have to, at the same time, work on bringing on more affordable units to create that capacity. But you are right that the expectation is that people are moving through the system. They're getting addiction support if they need it, mental health support if they need it, job training if they need it, finding a job, getting a couple of months savings under their belt, and then moving into a unit long term. I'll tell you right now from our current sites, and it's a smaller number of sites, but our current sites, the biggest problem has not been people not willing to get access to services or treatment. It's been them getting a job and still being stuck waiting for a unit to move to. And so that's another problem we're trying to solve. But the expectation is everyone is on the path to treatment, to work, or in the event that we have someone that has long-term physical or mental disabilities that will make work not possible, then we're connecting them to benefits that would pay for long-term housing. And so, and the path is, I think, regularly kind of 3 to 6 months for that trajectory, but we're monitoring that every day and evaluating our providers on how well they're doing on getting folks up and out of that system into a long-term place. Yes, you bet. Yes, sir.
Christopher Mutzers, John. I want to follow up about that. What do you do with the people who, like where they are?
Yeah.
They don't want to go in a shelter because they can't continue to do stuff that they're doing on the streets. They don't want to go into tiny homes or pallet homes. And I think they, yeah. I live about two blocks from the building.
Yes.
Site, and we were talking to some of the police officers there, and the social work with them. We went to every last tent. None of them wanted to go. Yeah, except the events for you. None of them wanted to go. And what do you do with the people who want to stay when they're there?
Yeah, so great question. And this actually, sir, to your point, is a question I've learned from the feedback we've gotten. The question
definitely
was about
what, hear that.
Yeah, the question was about what do we do with folks who, even when offered housing, won't take it or don't take it? What is the next step? It's a really important question. And I'd say there are two parts. And I've been to that encampment several times, talked to folks there several times. I think the difference between what we have to offer them right now and what we have to offer them when we get housing units on is significant. What we have to offer them now, because I know what our caseworkers are offering them, is shelter access. Do you want to go to a shelter, which is what we call a congregate living site, where you're in a gymnasium floor with 100 other people on a mat. You are right that a large number of people do not take that offer because they find it as more dangerous sometimes than staying on the street, the more inconvenient. I can't tell you the folks I've talked to around house who say, I had a job and I went and stayed in a shelter overnight. My phone got stolen. Now I can't get back hold of my boss to be able to show up and find out what she have to show up to. Or I was there, I went to work for the day, came back to my tent and all my stuff was gone. And so now we have to find a rotating service to keep people safe during the day. So when you change the offer, the uptake changes dramatically. We think it's about 80-90% from survey data who would take a tiny home or a hotel conversion or a lease unit that would not take a shelter. We can argue about why that is, but that data is very important, and it's part of the reason why we're pursuing this strategy, not just saying let's build more shelters. Your question is still totally applicable, which is even if that works, there's still maybe 10%. The only debate is it 10% who say no, or is it 50% who say no? Our data indicates it's much closer to 10 to 20% who won't take them. And the good and the bad news is that 20% is disproportionately the population with the most profound addiction, the most profound mental health needs, and committing the most amount of crimes. So what we find right now is part of this strategy is that when we move people that are ready to go to housing into housing, we will still have those 100 people left who refuse to go, who are committing an overwhelming number of crimes. What we also have in that situation is our capacity for our law enforcement now to focus really committed resources on those 100 people. Right now, those people are blended in indiscriminately with folks who are just trying to get their lives back together, who are working, who are doing no harm, who want housing. And it's much harder to discern them. Even when we've had shootings at encampments, I've been to multiples of them. And you'll have folks that are just asleep in their beds at night who are former military veterans who get shot in the back, like this young man, Joseph, we talked to. And you'll have folks that are there dealing drugs and causing that ruckus and shooting. We have to separate those two populations. When we can, it allows us to really enforce on the populations that are committing crimes. And I will tell you what I've said every night when we do town halls is there are two parts of my commitment here. One is we want to get people off the streets and into housing. Second is we want everyone to feel safe again in their neighborhoods all around the city. And that means enforcing the law on people that are breaking the law. So we will do that. We will bring people in that are committing those charges, that are committing those crimes. We will try to get them access to treatment if that's what we know their needs are, voluntarily. And if they're not willing to take voluntary treatment, then we will charge them and prosecute them. And we will get them access to inpatient treatment, or even in a jail-based setting, you can get access to a mental health or addiction-based treatment program to help get you healthy and back on your feet. But we are not going to tolerate the level of lawlessness that happens right now. This just makes it easier for us to address that.
Thanks so much for your attention.
No, it's a really great question. It's one I hear almost every night. It's what I think people are very concerned about. Yes, sir. Good to see you.
Yeah, you too. Actually, I was at that encampment working with the Headwaters people a couple weeks ago.
At 8th and Logan?
Yeah.
Yep.
And I was wondering, one thing you didn't mention, but I assume this must be part of your plan, is when you start moving people into these communities, whether it's a hotel, leasing, or micro community, you will try to keep those groups together as much as possible, because it seems like there's more willingness to go somewhere if they might be going with a lot of the people they've been camped out with.
Yeah, you're 100% right. Did you all hear that question? That was a close one, so I thought you could.
Yes.
You're 100% right on two functions. One is the reason why we do this by with larger numbers. If you have an encampment with 40 people on that site, that's about 40 people on it right now at 8th and Logan. So what we don't want to do is open five units, then go to that encampment and pull five people out of it. Because what happens is those five either leave their community, or even if those five move, the encampment still stays there. And then 3-5 days later, five new people will fill those spots and there's no change in the neighborhood. So the idea is two things. One is we actually open up sites at larger volume so we can move 50 of those people all at once. For those folks that want to stay in that same community, they can do that. And that a lot of people choose to do that because they've really camped with the folks that are their last, you know, kind of these friends of the family you've chosen. This is the family they've chosen. That may be who they have left as their supports. So it allows those supports to move together. It also allows other kinds of choice, which is we might have someone in that encampment who would say, you know what, I'm a veteran, and I'd really like to be housing other veterans, if that's possible. We have 40% of our youth who are homeless right now identify as LGBTQ. We've had sites that have either been for women or trans or non-binary. We have those that have focused on LGBTQ identifying. And so sometimes it offers us different choices among the communities, but most often what we find is people want to move with the folks that they're currently living next to. And generally what you find is these sites tip, where there's 10 or 20 people who came and lived in the site together, and then a couple of weeks down the road, other folks start coming to prey on those people who are in those sites. That's when we start to lose control of these sites, is when they see it as a target. And when I talked to folks at the Logan, they said, you know, for 2 weeks, this site was great. There's all our friends here. We kept it total tidy and clean. We made sure it was well taken care of. Then other folks started coming. We tried to ask them to keep it clean. They got into conflict. And so we've seen that trend happen multiple times, where a small community loses control of the site and they lose control of the safety because they can't keep the boundaries.
Before we jump into more in-person questions, we've got a few online questions.
Oh, sorry. Yes.
We have our senior outreach manager, Peter.
I'll be asking the questions. There's a little question from Graham Kay. Graham Kay's question is, what are the screening?
Why don't you come up there, Peter?
Yeah, that's a good idea. Good solution.
Graham Kay asks, what are the screenings for people who are being placed in tiny homes? In particular, are we allowing people with history of violence or sexual assault convictions?
The current approach is that what we are focusing on is moving people directly out of encampments where they're living on the street and into housing. So it is not, there are other places that do much more elaborate screening systems where you first go to a shelter location and you apply for a shelter, or you have temporary housing and you apply from that. We're moving people directly from encampments into housing because it both addresses the neighborhood need we have, it addresses those people most at risk, and it most quickly resolves the challenge. These do not have entry level screening for admission. I want to be clear on that. And we visit sites around the country, and none of the ones we visited that do this effectively have that screening in place. Turns out you cannot solve the challenge of homelessness by pushing people back into homelessness for failure to meet that criteria. What we do have, absolutely, is very stringent rules and responsibilities about behavior in those sites when you arrive. That's why you have around-the-clock security. That's why you have rules around no distribution of drugs, no public use, no violence, no assault. Many of them have no visitors or no unregistered members who can come and visit the site. So they do have, this is why these sites have been so successful at keeping criminal behavior so low, is because they have rules that are strict. And if people violate those rules, they are kicked out or they are charged. So that's the nature of having security on site all the time, is if that happens, you can't intervene. And that has been very successful. So I understand it can be worrisome to say, why is there not a screening mechanism? We view it as lower screening on the front end, much higher enforcement once you arrive at the location. And that is a strategy that's worked so far.
Got one more online question.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
I'm gonna get back up here. So we have a question from Libby. Libby asks, current micro communities are beyond big fences. Will there be fences around these new ones?
Joshua, you can correct me if I'm wrong. I guess Joshua just left, so you can't correct me. Our plans are, the question is around whether all the micro communities will be fenced. I think our current expectation is that they will all be fenced. And so that also provides some structure to the space. People can't wander in and out of the campus. There's an entrance, there's staff at the entrance. Because again, part of what we find in the encampments are, it's hard to discern from the folks living in the encampments and the folks that approach them for ill will. So this allows us to control that. That's why we would fence them. Yes.
We'll go in person questions.
Yes, sir.
Thanks for your update today. I'm interested in the wraparound services aspect of this. What's the status of finding the people to provide the wraparound services, and do you have any concerns for finding skilled workers to cover all the sites you mentioned?
Did you all get that question?
That was good. Thank you.
This was, I think, the second meeting or third meeting we had. The first day we announced the emergency declaration, either before or after we met with the RNOs, which was with all the providers around the city who are able to provide these services. Because we knew that was a big need. How are we going to bring on the staff? Because it took the city, gosh, I don't know, 3 years to pilot one microsite. And so that's a little different than going from one to 10 or 11 in 6 months. So we went out to those providers early and said, we want you to start building capacity. They're doing that. We're working with the foundation community to help them build capacity along the way. Another big thing that they asked us to do that we are doing is we broke down the RFPs into smaller pieces. So before it used to be, here is a 200-person hotel. Can you run the entire thing soup to nuts? Can you do building maintenance? Can you do facility? Can you do finance? Can you do operations? Can you do mental health support? Can you do workforce training? Can you do wraparound addiction-based services? Can you do special services for folks who have issues of domestic violence abuse? Like, that's very hard for one nonprofit to do a lot of. So now we've broken those down into 7 or 8 pieces. So you could say, you know what? I have a nonprofit. What we do is just we specifically work with women who have previous histories of domestic violence. That's our support service. And we can plug that in as part of the solution. Someone else who just does addiction treatment or just does workforce training or someone that just does systems management, we try to spread them out, which means a lot more nonprofits than had played before can now participate. Before it was a very small number of providers that ran almost all of these sites, really only two that had run them previously. And so that's helped us expand who can provide it and how they can provide it. And then that's also why I will tell you, I'm in the day right now where like every day feels like it lasts forever because we have folks living at 8th and Logan that we can't get into housing and living at 16th and Sherman. Every time I walk by, I don't want to pull my hair out. And people in the Emergency Operations Center are saying, we are moving as fast as we can to stand up 11 sites in 6 months, but it took us 3 years to do one site, so give us a break. But I will say the other people who said they needed that amount of time was the providers. They said, we can't give you staffing for 11 sites in 30 days, so you've got to give us 3 or 4 months to find those people, train those people, recruit those people. So that's what's happening right now.
They will find
the people. Yeah, they feel very optimistic about that capacity with that timeline. Two things they needed was one timeline, two is more access for smaller nonprofits, and three is the knowledge that there were resources there to actually commit. As you know, as a nonprofit, it's hard to build the church for Easter Sunday if no one's coming. You got to actually know that there are resources coming.
Thanks.
Yes.
So we're all RNO people. We have constituents that are NIMBYs and people that are NIMBYs, and we have an analogy to what you're trying to accomplish, which is when developers come to us and pitch a project, a multi-unit project, and they come with eye candy, they come with concepts that perhaps won't be fulfilled, but are part of their aspiration. A lot of what's gotten out in the public so far has been at a very high level and without anything to grab onto. I mean, a general rendering, anonymous, not named at any particular site, of a batch of pallet homes or something like that with fencing and so on and so forth would go a long ways to broadening the channels to communication. And second, I live a half block from the 2301 South Santa Fe site, and It's a very forbidding site at the moment, light, and we're very keen that it not be a case of light on light. I don't think that would be the outcome. But it doesn't have water, it doesn't have sewer. Power is an easy tap, and you've got to deal with CDOT. We're keen to watch the development going forward. I was at a meeting with five different RMAs for District 7, and we were all cautiously supportive of the idea and concept, the aspiration and concept. But we need help helping you mediate to the folks that are alarmed, whose experiences have been entirely negative, or who just have an entirely negative nature.
Thank you so much for that.
Please summarize it. Thank you. Summary.
Because I think two things. One is, what sort of resources do we have that we could offer that would help give people a better sense of what this will actually look like? Maps, floor plans, visualizations. That's question one. And to that, I believe, Jordan, is our video of a micro community site, is that now live?
Yes, we have a video of what it'll look like. We can send that out to all of you guys after this meeting, so you guys can share it with your neighbors.
That would be really helpful. I will tell you, that happened because for the first, 20 community meetings, I was telling people to go visit the 40th and Monroe site. Apparently, when I told 3,000 people to do that, about 500 of them did. And so they've now said, stop sending us people. We're trying to run a site. We're not running a museum. We're giving you the video one, which is easier to deliver and distribute than the actual site visit. But maybe just sneak by and you can look over the fence. That's one. Second one was just about the 23rd and 2301 South Santa Fe and the concern that there's some blight there now. How do we avoid this being an additional challenge, and how to work with CDOTs and the other local neighborhood partners around access to utilities, et cetera. And this is one where a lot of sites you start, you're not sure what the problems are going to be and how they'll get better. And sometimes you think, oh gosh, working with CDOT, that's going to be impossible. They've actually been really helpful. I just met with CDOT today, with she and the governor, and we're working on these sites. The ability to look at that site and say, what do we need for electricity? For those locations, we bring on a community. Usually you think about the layout you'll see in this video is, 50 to 100 potentially tiny home sites within a community center. It's a shared community space, and that space comes in and has all of the water, sewage, bathrooms, kitchen, showers, all in that set location. So you're not having to run 100 pipes. You're actually just running one set, which is easier to do on utilities. I've been at that site multiple times myself. I think similarly, kind of fence dilapidated on the Santa Fe side, there's opportunity to really stabilize and secure that space, make it very well kept and well preserved. And so this is what we find this in a number of sites where people will come to us and say, I have this current site that is dilapidated, run down, impossible to maintain, folks are grifting through it, camping on it, I can't chase them off of it, and it's unsafe. Would you please take it? Because we think it's better to have that place safe and secure and monitored than not. So we are optimistic this could be a good example of a place that actually works better as a supervised, inhabited, well-used site than one that is kind of underutilized and falls into blight. So we're optimistic we can make progress there, and we've had good feedback so far.
In your first meeting, you said 4 years, TMC, that's the yep. T, temporary. Is that commitment still in place firmly?
So at 4 years is actually the outer boundaries of the zoning allowance. So that's by law it can go beyond four. So we actually talk about it in terms of 2 to 4. I think it could be shorter. It could be, but it wouldn't right now. The maximum capacity would be 4. We also have partners that have land that they're thinking about developing, but in this investment climate or in this current moment, they're saying it's probably going to take me 2 years before I start, then 2 years to get permits once I do start. We're trying to make that faster. So that also has helped us for short term. Yes, that is still the plan. And again, the only thing we have to solve for there is getting the actual affordable units up and ready so we can move folks out of these sites and into more permanent housing.
So before we move on to in-person questions, we want to give our folks online a chance to ask as well.
We have a question for Michael. Michael asks, Mayor, how will we prevent drug dealers from dealing just outside the gates of these communities, micro communities?
Great. And that's why I think the data about the micro communities is so helpful, because that includes calls to those sites and to around those sites. So it's not been a situation where, oh, no drug dealing is happening inside a micro community, but there's a massive market that operates outside the front door every day. These providers that are the ones we're working with are ones who have run sites effectively because they take ownership out of being great neighbors. We'll also have good neighbor agreements with each of these sites. So the neighborhoods and the nonprofit that are the providers will enter into good neighbor agreements on what this will look like. And so the short answer is we will enforce that both in the site and around the site. We have security there. We'll have around the clock staffing. And we also have our own police department that will know where these sites are, and we'll be doing additional supervision and drive-bys to make sure that those places are kept safe. And so for those officers also, I mean, I would say one of the upsides of 8th and Logan is it's grown large. Interestingly, we've actually gotten fewer volume of complaints from the neighborhood, because those 30 tents used to be spread across 30 blocks. So everyone had one tent in front of their front yard that they were very upset about. Now we have it in one site, which has different problems, but it's actually much easier for us to supervise, enforce, put police department supervision on than it is in separate sites. And there's no supervision or structure there. In a real site with real structure and support, you have much better outcomes. So we're both monitoring within the site, monitoring around the site, and that's the expectation of our providers to take contracts, that they'll do that and do it well.
Thank you very much. And so we have one more question, I think, from Libby too. And you might have touched on this briefly, but the question was, so we understand there's 1,000 units that are being created. How do you plan on allocating these 1,000 units? If you can touch base on that again.
Great. So the focus, as I think I may have mentioned, is that we are moving people by geography. So this is not if someone's on a wait list, they've been on for 7 months, where do we place them? We're going to an encampment that's on 8th and Logan, and we're saying, all right, we're closing this encampment down. We're moving you all into housing. Let's match you to a unit. We'll move you out, close the encampment, keep the encampment closed, keep the neighborhood closed, camping. So we are focusing the strategy then on starting in places where there are the highest density of encampments and moving out geographically. So a lot of that highest density right now is in District 9 and District 10. You all that are here from that neighborhood know that. There's density obviously in other parts of the city, but we'll start with the highest density areas, then move out. We're getting initial counts of where people are. And I think even if you take the whole central business district right now, it looks like there are somewhere around 600 people that are in that area alone. We believe we ought to be able to rehouse all the people in that district, plus a lot of the surrounding neighborhoods. And so we're also working with the police department. We're working with arts and venues. Working with Dottie, working with community partners like Dream Center. I see Pastor B here. Because we're going to have a whole network of activation that happens in those sites, that after we close them, we have barbecues, we have outdoor events, we have public activation, we have business happy hours, we have PD who is doing drive-bys, we have nonprofits doing outreach. So those sites stay active for the whole neighborhood. So we don't know yet exactly how far that geography goes. One of the challenges, we're still 60 days away from having units ready. And as you know, week to week, these encampments can move significantly. So what was a small site could be a large one could be cleaned, a small one could grow to be large. So we're mapping them as we go, but our hope is it'll be a significant amount of the most densely packed neighborhoods with encampments today will be part of this first tranche in December.
Thank you.
You bet. Yes, sir.
So I want to make sure I get this question right, but they're on the campaign track. You mentioned $250 million, I believe, 25,000 units. I'm in the design and construction industry. That math doesn't really work out that well. So are there going to be, I'm assuming there's going to be hundreds of millions of dollars more than that spent on this. How are you going to sell that? And in addition to that, are you talking about doing sustainable design construction so that these people have healthy places to live in, using less energy, using less water, because we're going to have thousands more people in homes using resources that we are already struggling with.
I think I can answer this question by repeating the question, but for the folks online, because I think you were asking about our broader affordable housing strategy in addition to the unhoused neighbors. Is that correct?
Just the unhoused part.
Okay, so that's great. So you actually paid careful attention on the campaign. There are two separate areas of focus here. The 25,000 number I gave, which I did give, is around permanently affordable units of housing for folks at all levels of working class. That is 3,000 units a year, every year for the next 8 years. That strategy is really focused on your teachers, your nurses, your servers, your wait staff, your retail workers that can't afford to live in the city right now. That's around subsidizing affordable housing for those folks. And as you know, as a developer, this is more about filling gaps in development costs than it is about covering the entire cost of the unit. So it's about providing some financing that makes a unit from being unaffordable to making it affordable. Happy to talk more with you about this. But so, and that is closer to about 100 million a year, every year over the next 8 years. So that's not a, that's 250 million is the city budget for that every single year. So that's 2.25 billion, 2.5 billion over 10 years. So that is a broader focus on affordable housing, which we'll do a lot more of. That includes things like rental assistance and eviction protection to make sure folks that are currently at the risk of becoming homeless don't become homeless. That saves us a lot of money and better outcomes. On the direct services for people that are homeless, we're really focused on this 1,500 to 2,000 that are living unsheltered in the streets right now. And that's our focus on 1,000 for this year. We'll likely have another 1,000 to do next year. So that's the pace at which that's going. But it's overall a much smaller piece of the puzzle than the whole affordable housing budget. Think about this as a kind of $50 million chunk in a $250 million budget, of which another 150 to 200 is focused on affordable housing for all income distributions over the long term. We're doing a budget rollout for 2024 this Thursday. And that'll lay out all the tranches of that budget for 2024.
So now we have time for one more question.
Nice to see you, Mr. Mayor. I, as you know, I'm a survivor of domestic violence and an advocate, so thank you for bringing this up. I really want to worry about that root cause and what solution that you have with that, in particular, in working with more domestic violence. And I also worry about, while domestic violence is still happening, they're then becoming as well. And so what do we have specifically for survivors and victims of domestic violence?
Did you all hear that? I can translate. It was around what are we doing specifically around supporting survivors of domestic violence right now, and what are we doing around supporting those who are experiencing domestic violence, maybe at risk of becoming homeless without intervention? Is that the right? So the good news is the first one, we put out an RFP right now for services, service providers across the city. That is out on the street right now. So we are doing a call for providers to come in. We've not contracted any of them. We're in the seeking partnership stage. And so we're hoping that there are people that will come in and apply with that expertise. If you have folks in your network, please have them do that. I think on the how we intervene to prevent folks who are at risk of that from becoming homeless, a couple things. One is we partner with organizations like the Rosandom Center, which I'm sure you may have heard of, which Rosandom does specific focus on people with histories of being victims of domestic violence or survivors, who helps them get into temporary or more transitional housing units. We have a number of intake partners, including places like the Solution Center, that allows people that have that current experience to find access to those services and get placed. So we do have a couple of interventions currently for people that are housed but experiencing domestic violence to get out of that current setting and into a safe shelter or housing opportunity. We'll keep doing those, and we'll keep focusing on services for people that are unhoused and that are trying to build their way back up. We want to do it on both sides of the spectrum.
What if one of those organizations is not really serving the community? And on paper, it looks like they are, but thousands of families are not being serviced by one of those partners. Then what do we do? Because unfortunately, some of these nonprofits then become corporatized, and it's just a game where the mayor's office or our city is funding these places that are really not taking care of the families that need the help.
Yeah, I think this is one of our biggest concerns. We get this feedback on different kinds of providers in different spaces, and this is why we want a system that provides really clear accountability for what outcomes people are delivering. How many individuals are you serving? What results are those individuals having? How many of them are going on to permanent housing? How long are they staying in housing? Are they not recidivating back to being homeless again? Are they able to get services for the needs that they have? And so I'd love your feedback maybe offline and how we can work on that, because what we want to do is make sure we're both supporting organizations to do the work and making sure that if we are supporting those organizations, they're really tending to their constituents and doing it well. We have had a number of Places where we've gotten feedback from residents in these locations that they weren't treated with dignity or from other surrounding partners. And so that's made us step back and design these RFPs to open it up to far more partners so they can not have a monopoly on these services and to make sure we can hold them accountable along the way. I'll just wrap it with a couple of closing thoughts. First of all, thank you all so much for being here, and thank you for all the work that you do doing this outreach to your neighbors and residents every day, all the time. We're really excited to build a much deeper, stronger, ongoing partnership with the RNOs across the city so that we can both be able to get information to you early and often for you to be able to talk to your neighbors about, and for you to bring information to us if there are concerns you have, issues that we're not addressing, places where the city's letting us down on public services. We want them to know that and help fix that. That's why, as Andrea said, we have this team who are doing direct outreach from our office to you. So if you have a question, you ought to get straight to our office, and we can get straight to you with those. And so please think about this as the start of a much stronger partnership around how we can provide all the needs of your neighbors. And that just we take very seriously the concerns that people have about this issue. And we take very seriously our obligation to both deliver services for folks that are unhoused and to deliver safety for all your neighbors that are housed. And so we are fully committed to doing that and to delivering on that. And so, and your job is to hold us accountable for that. And so if we do have a site we stand up that is adding light to the neighborhood and not fixing it, we expect you to tell us and tell us early. What I always say is I'm not always going to be right, but I am always going to kind of lead with courage and conviction and then listen and take feedback, figure out what worked, figure out what didn't, and then get better the second time around. What we don't want to do is spend 2 years waiting or thinking or reading our hands. We want to be able to take action immediately, get folks connected to services, and then have you tell us what's working and what's not. So I would really ask for and invite your partnership in that in an ongoing way. Because we have a lot more work to do in addition to this. Now, this is stage one. We then have the whole task on affordable housing for all the rest of our citizens across the city. We have a whole task on public safety that extends much beyond just the homeless population. We got people's cars being stolen, houses being broken into, and murders happening, and shootings. You know, that's a whole separate set of needs. We have the whole revitalization of both the city center and the rest of our neighborhoods around economic recovery. And so we're going to be partners in all these things and really want to be able to be in close contact and communication with you. I think maybe the last story I'll tell is about my 8th and Logan visit, which is, I think it's a very fair question people ask about in terms of what we see now versus what we can hope about what's possible if this works. And what I find is it's a function of how we see people and how we invite them to show up and how we show up for them. And so when I went to visit Nathan Logan, I was there talking to some people and I ran across a guy who was, he looked pretty kooky. He had like ski goggles on, no shirt, shorts, running around. Stopped, introduced myself to him, told him who I was. Said that we were here to talk about housing. So we're trying to bring on actual housing units. We want to figure out how we can get people connected to housing. And probably 20 seconds into the conversation, he disappears. I was like, all right, well, that was the end of that conversation. Along with the next 10 of talking, and about 30 seconds later, he comes back and taps me on the shoulder. I turn around as he is now in khakis and a dress shirt. Turned back into his tent, put on his best clothes, and he says, I am just looking for a chance to find a job and to try to get housing. Like, if you can help me do any of those things, I will do whatever is required to do that. But like, I was waiting for someone to take a chance on me. And like, if you all are willing to do that, I'm all with you. And I think, well, that's what I find over and over in this feedback is that I'm not arguing with anyone else that there aren't people who are living their lives at their worst right now or at their lowest point they've ever been. I have family members who are addicts, as I'm sure folks in this room do, and we've seen some dark days. I know what that looks like. But there are people all around the city right now who are fundamentally waiting for us to make a bet on them and waiting for us to call them to be the best version of themselves. What we know is when we do that, they respond by really rising to that occasion. And so our expectation is not that we'll continue to allow them to be the worst version of themselves, it's that we actually invite them to be that best version in the khaki pants with the shirt on saying, how can I get to work? And I'll tell you, when I walked away, the next thing he did was Councilman Hines was there with me during that site visit, and he used his wheelchair, and he was at the end of the block coming up. And he saw Councilman Hines coming and went and cleared the entire sidewalk. This is, he didn't want Councilman Hines to not be able to make up the sidewalk, whatever stuff. Not his stuff, not his tent, not his yard. He just said, this guy who's coming to help, I want to make sure you get here. So For me and all of the challenge, it's good to have the affirmation of that there is the capacity to do something transformational for the lives of folks who need this the most. And I think also transformational for our neighborhoods. We all want back a sense of safety and security and stability and belonging, and to feel proud of the fact this is not just a great city, but a good city at the same time. Thank you to both of us. So thank you so much for being here.
Thank you again very much for attending today's information session. So raise your hands if you're district 1 and 3. 1 and 3, okay? You are assigned to my senior outreach manager, Alex Gutierrez, if you can see him. The guy in the back over there, fantastic. And then Peter Lumbella, you're going to be taking districts?
8, 9, and 11. But really come to Adam before you leave.
And if you don't know who to come to, come chat with me and I can sort you out with somebody. Thank you again for coming.
Andres, I'm looking for Tron.
Tron, yes, you're not getting your work. Yes, exactly. All right, so, let's start with the people who are 2, 7, and 4. 2, 7, and 4, okay. So, take out your cell phones. I have an Arizona Limited School program. This is, again, if you live in 2, 7, and 4. Yeah, I'm sorry. All right. Okay. All right. So then if you live in districts 10, 5, and 6, all right, I'm going to give you my cell phone number. My name is Andres. It's like Andrew with National Satellite Computer. Last name? Yeah. Good, good. And my cell phone number is 720-415-887. Any other questions I can help answer? Yes, Andres Dunn, correct.
Yes.
You can say you should have had movements from, you know, that communication. Feel free to contact me. I can be your first way of entry, okay? And then if I'm not the right person to speak with, then I can maybe also, right? Yeah, but I'd be more than happy to just sort of answer that. So unfortunately, the city council just is on the fourth floor, actually. And so, you know, if you have any messages for us, we can pass it on to the city council. So if you want to talk to the mayor, you know, reach out to one of my senior outreach managers, myself. You know, if you want to talk to the council members, reach out to them. Yes, so yes, it's up to hire my core senior officer.
Okay, so and then
I have a little bit of a question.